because of the lockdown, we felt that it would be nice to have a series of lectures on basic quantum mechanics for the benefit of students. And this is being conducted under the Delhi chapter of the National Academy of Sciences, which is the oldest science academy in India, along with Deen Dayal Upadhyaya College under the aegis of DBT Star College program in the Department of Electronics. He is putting in tremendous amount of effort in seeing that. So he's doing that from his home and spending his time for the benefit of students. So I would request all of you, there is a background noise which is coming, to switch off your mic and switch off your camera. Okay? So if you have any comments, in fact, I would like you to send your, Dr. Saxena will tell you to send your comments and suggestions to this email address. Since some of you did not attend the first lecture, I thought I will give you the references. These are the four classic books on quantum mechanics. The first one is the Feynman lectures by Richard Feynman himself, and Principles of Quantum Mechanics by Dirac. This is a classic book. And then Quantum Theory by David Bohm, and Quantum Mechanics by Cohen Tanuji and his collaborators. Richard Feynman, Dirac, and Cohen Tanuji are all Nobel laureates. So they are all authorities in their field. And David Bohm is considered as one of the greatest authorities in quantum mechanics. But you will see, if you get a chance to read any of the books, then each book has a different perspective, different way of solving different problems in quantum mechanics. So in that sense, quantum mechanics is really a very unique subject. And I thought I will give you a glimpse of that in this lecture. I will follow my own books. And on the left is the sixth edition of our book with Professor Lokanathan on quantum mechanics, theory and applications. And in the sixth edition of optics, I have introduced a chapter on quantum theory, two chapters actually. And I will be closely following the notations which are given in chapters 9, 10, and 26. So after the lecture is over, I'm sure all of you are very serious about it. I would like you to go through these chapters and try to understand as much as possible. In the previous lecture that was held on 31st of March, we had discussed experiments which demonstrate wave and particle aspects of light, as well as experiments which demonstrate wave and particle aspects of electron, proton, alpha particles, etc. So essentially, we discussed in detail the wave-particle duality. So the question arises whether the electron is a wave or a particle. And we discussed it yesterday on the last lecture, that Richard Feynman writes, in fact, he said in his famous Feynman lectures, that they are neither waves nor particles. So the answer to the question, some books write that they are sometimes particles, sometimes waves, sometimes both, that is not quite correct. So if you ask me the question, whether the electron or a proton or an alpha particle, is it a wave or a particle? then the correct answer is that they are neither waves nor particles. So what are they then? This is a photograph of Richard Feynman delivering his famous Feynman lectures. And I would like all of you to listen to the Feynman lectures. No. Listen to the Feynman lectures, which are on YouTube. You go to YouTube and write Feynman messenger lectures. So, as I mentioned, that is the electron and a proton. So they are neither waves nor particles. So what are they then? So in quantum theory, they are described by the wave function psi. So the electron, let us suppose I have a free electron and a free proton. They are described by the wave function psi. So what is this psi? This psi is the solution of the Schrödinger equation. And this is the Schrödinger equation. So how did I get it? Where did it come from? So Feynman writes very beautifully in his lecture that where did we get that equation from? The answer is nowhere. It is not possible to derive it from anything you know. And he writes, Feynman writes, it came out of the mind of Schrödinger. So that is the thing that I wanted to emphasize even in my last lecture, that there is no rigorous derivation of the Schrödinger equation. There's some hand-waving argument that one gives to arrive at the Schrödinger equation. And I will give you one such argument to arrive at. And I discussed that last time. I'll just go through that very briefly. So this is a classical plane wave where psi of xt represents the displacement. For an electromagnetic wave, it is the electric or magnetic field. For a water wave, it is the displacement of water molecules. So this is the classical plane wave where k is equal to 2 pi by lambda and omega is equal to 2 pi nu. Now in quantum mechanics, we represent the displacement by the wave function, which describes the electron or the proton, and then somehow introduce the wave particle duality. So we have the de Broglie relation, p is equal to h by lambda, which I write as h by 2 pi, 2 pi by lambda, which is h cross k, where k is this wave vector. So I can write k is equal to p by h cross, where h cross is equal to h by 2 pi. We also have the Einstein relation, e is equal to h nu, which is equal to h cross omega. So omega is equal to e by h cross. So I substitute this in this equation. I want to describe a particle whose momentum is p and whose energy is e. So I describe it by a wave function like this. So I start with a wave function like this, where I have introduced, where I have used wave particle duality to write the displacement like this. Now, if I differentiate with respect to, partially differentiate with respect to time, and multiply by IH cross, then you will see IH cross times I by H cross is minus 1, minus into minus is plus. So you will get E times the whole expression. So if I differentiate this with respect to time and multiply by IH cross, then I will get E psi. Then I differentiate this twice, delta 2 psi by delta x square. So you will get p square by h cross square. And then I multiply by h cross square by 2m. So I get p square by 2m. So I have differentiated this once with respect to time, twice with respect to x, to obtain these equations. Now, for a free particle, E is equal to p square by 2m. So therefore, E psi is equal to p square by 2m psi, because the right-hand sides are equal. So therefore, the left-hand sides must also be equal. And so we have this one-dimensional, time-dependent Schrödinger equation from a free particle. So I've given a very heuristic argument, a heuristic proof, which is not rigorously correct, to arrive at this equation. Then I consider the same particle in a potential field. Then the total energy of the particle is equal to p square by 2m plus v of x, where v of x is the potential energy function. And so therefore, you can write another equation, which is v times psi is equal to v times psi. Now see what I have done. IH cross delta psi by delta t is equal to E psi, where E is equal to p square by 2m plus v of x psi. But p square by 2m psi is so much, and v of x psi is v x psi. So I have somehow arrived at the time-dependent Schrödinger equation, one-dimensional, in a potential field v of x. So therefore, one-dimensional, this is the one-dimensional time-dependent Schrödinger equation. And if you had worked in the three dimension, so that psi is now a, this is r vector. I have written this as bold. R vector means it represents x, y, and z. It's in a three-dimensional space. Similarly, the potential energy function is x, y, function of x, y, z. And del square psi is delta 2 psi by delta x square plus delta 2 psi by delta y square plus delta 2 psi. So, in fact, if instead of a one-dimensional wave, I had used a three-dimensional wave, then I would have arrived at this equation. Now I have given a very hurried derivation, which is not rigorous. I must repeat this. So Schrödinger equation cannot be derived. And the entire non-relativistic quantum mechanics, because I have assumed E is equal to p square by 2m plus v of x. So this is a non-relativistic expression for total energy. And so therefore, the entire field of, there are books written on non-relativistic Schrödinger equation. That is just solution of this equation for different forms of V of R. So what I have told you is the following. Listen to it carefully. That the entire non-relativistic quantum mechanics is essentially a solution of the three-dimensional and or sometimes the one-dimensional Schrödinger equation. And different problems correspond to different forms of the potential energy function. And I should take the Schrödinger equation as the Bible. Don't question it. You don't question as to how I have got it. So as Feynman has said, no one can derive the Schrödinger equation rigorously. Now, for example, in classical electricity and magnetism, you write the Maxwell's equations. Maxwell's equations are experimental laws. They describe experimental laws, like a changing magnetic field produces a changing electric field, or a current produces a magnetic field. These are experimental laws. And then you solve them. So the entire field of classical electricity and magnetism are solutions of the Schrödinger of the Maxwell's equations for different boundary conditions, for different media, for different boundaries and things like that. And Maxwell's equations cannot be derived. Similarly, the entire field of non-relativistic quantum mechanics is essentially a solution of the three-dimensional Schrödinger equation, which cannot be derived, which cannot, does not have a rigorous derivation. Okay. So as I showed you last time, it's so popular and it's so beautiful that many people have tattooed them on their skin. So in this and probably the following lecture, I will consider a free particle. So this is, so I start with this. Don't ask me how I have got this. Ye kahan se aaya, I will not, I do not have to answer that. So is equation se shuru karke, I assume V of x is equal to zero, and I get the, and I start with this, that a free particle is described by this equation, by the wave function psi, which satisfies this equation. So therefore, a free electron or a free proton or a free neutron or a free alpha particle, or for that matter, any particle, is described by the wave function psi. And that is, what is psi? It is the solution of this equation. That's it. So I start my presentation by just obtaining a solution of this equation, and then physically interpret it to represent an actual electron. But before that, to understand the solution of the Schrödinger equation, one has to understand, it should be good to understand the delta function and the Fourier transform. So, which I am going to do in the next half hour or so. So, I consider a rectangle function, which is equal to 1 over 2 sigma when x lies between a minus sigma and a plus sigma, and 0 for the. So if I assume sigma is equal to 0.4, so I'm going to talk about the Dirac delta function. So in order to understand the solution of for the free particle, which is slightly difficult, and Fourier transform, I have to understand the delta function and the Fourier transform. So I consider a rectangle function, which is equal to 1 over 2 sigma for x lying between a plus sigma and a minus sigma, and 0 otherwise. So you have here, so dekho, see the arrow. So you 0 here, and then a small number, which is 1 over 2 into 0.4. So the width of a, this is 2 sigma. That is, a is equal to 2. So this is 0.8. And this is 1 over 0.8. So therefore, the area under the curve is 1. So the area under the curve is 1 for all values of sigma. So let us reduce the value of sigma, and you obtain, say, 0.1. Sigma is equal to 0.1. Then this is 0.2. The width is 0.2, 2 sigma, and the height is 5. Because 1 over 0.2 is 5. I further reduce the value of sigma. So I plot this, as I was trying to tell you, for particular value of sigma. Then I reduce the value of sigma. It becomes narrower and sharper. And it becomes taller, narrower and taller. But the area under the curve always remains the same. So in the limit of sigma tending to zero, this function will be very thin and very tall. That is a simple representation of the Dirac delta function. So this is one of the representations of the Dirac delta function, that limit as sigma tends to zero of a rectangle function. Now, let us suppose I take the rectangle function, which is like this, 0 here, 2a minus sigma, and then 1 over 2 sigma, and then 0 beyond a plus sigma. And I multiply by this rectangle function by a function f of x. So the product is 0 for x less than a minus sigma and x greater than a plus sigma. So if I integrate this f of x with delta of x minus a, then I have shown that delta of x minus a is the limit of the rectangle function in the limit of sigma tending to zero. But this rectangle function is zero for x less than a minus sigma and greater than a plus sigma, so that the integral is only between a minus sigma to a plus sigma. So if sigma is made very small, then in this tiny domain of integration, f of x can be assumed to be constant and its value can be taken out at x is equal to a, and then this. So this quantity is 2 sigma, which will cancel out with this, and you will get f of x. So the Dirac delta function x minus a dx, if I multiply by any well-behaved function like f of x as shown in this diagram, then and I integrate this, then it picks up the value at x is equal to a. So in fact, if you read any book, then the definition of the Dirac delta function is that delta of x minus a is zero everywhere, excepting at x is equal to a. And at x is equal to a, it is not defined. It has an infinite value. But the area under the curve is 1. So if I multiply this function with f of x, I will get f of a. So these two equations define the Dirac delta function. And it is usually represented by an unit arrow at x is equal to a. Okay, so this is the definition, and which was introduced by Dirac, Paul Dirac. He introduced the delta function in his famous book, which I had referred to earlier, Principle of Quantum Mechanics, in 1930. As I will tell you, quantum mechanics was discovered in 1926, and within 2-3 years, Dirac wrote a classic book on principles of quantum mechanics, in which he laid down the foundations of quantum mechanics. However, this impulse function, this is also known as impulse function, was introduced around 1880 by the mathematician Oliver Heaviside. So he had introduced the impulse function, which is the same as the delta function. It is something like this. You have a laser pointer, you switch it on and switch it off, produce a pulse of very short duration, but carrying a certain amount of energy. So that is a pulse, that is an impulse. And Oliver Heaviside had introduced that function while discussing the creation of a pulse. I next consider a ramp function. This is a ramp function which I denote by f sigma of x, which is equal to 1 over 2 sigma. The slope is 1 over 2 sigma and is such that it is 0 everywhere else. It is something like this. Look at the arrow. So it is for, let us suppose sigma is equal to 2. So it is 0 and then it linearly climbs to a value 1 and becomes 0. So as I reduce the value of sigma, the step becomes sharper and sharper until for sigma equal to 0, the slope is infinite. So you have 0 everywhere and then it jumps to 1 and 0 everywhere. That is actually known as Heaviside unit step function. Now, if you take the derivative of this function, please see, this is 0 and then a constant and then 0. And the derivative will be 1 over 2 sigma. If I take the derivative of this function, then it is 1 over 2 sigma. So that is my rectangle function. So the derivative of the ramp function, what is the ramp function? Which is a constant, and then it climbs up and becomes 1 linearly. So the derivative of the ramp function is the rectangle function. So therefore, in the limit of sigma equal to 0, it becomes a Heaviside step function. This was also, this step function was introduced by Oliver Heaviside, about whom I had just mentioned. So when sigma is equal to 1, the derivative of this function is 0 and then constant and then 0. And as the value of sigma becomes smaller and smaller, it becomes sharper and sharper. So this is known as the unit step function. This is a unit step function at x is equal to 2. So a is equal to 2. And its derivative, which is derivative is 0 here, 0 here, but at infinite here. So the derivative of the unit step function is the delta function, is the Dirac delta function. So the derivative of the unit step function is the Dirac delta function, which is usually represented by a vertical arrow of unit length. Now, this problem comes in quantum mechanics, but let us do it as a mathematical problem. I have a function psi of x, which is e to the power of minus mod x. That is, for x less than 0, it is e to the power of plus x. So it decreases. It's a symmetric function. And for e to the power of minus x, it is x greater than 0. For x greater than 0. So if I take the derivative of this function, so please see, If I take the derivative, it becomes plus e to the power of x for x less than 0, and then minus e to the power of minus x, x less. I take the second derivative, then you get e to the power of x, and minus minus becomes it. So you can see that psi double prime of x is the same as psi of x. So one can think of writing psi double prime of x is equal to psi of x. But that is not correct, because psi prime of x has a discontinuity at x is equal to 0. It is plus e to the power of x and minus e to the power of minus x. So there is a discontinuity of the function. And so therefore, and the discontinuity is how much? Minus 2. Because as x increases, the value jumps by minus 2. So therefore, at x is equal to 0, the derivative is a delta function. So if you are given this function and you write the double derivative and you say psi double prime is equal to psi, that is a wrong answer. Instead, so this is psi double prime of x is equal to psi of x minus 2 times delta x. So that is the, so whenever a function has a discontinuity, then its derivative there is a Dirac delta function. I will also evaluate this integral. Most of you may have done this. So you have I square is equal to, I multiply this by e to the power of minus y square, and then now replaced by polar coordinate, where r square is equal to x square plus y square, and the r goes from 0 to infinity, and phi goes from 0 to 2 pi. The phi integral is 2 pi, and because of the factor r here, I can integrate, and this is a very simple integration, so again, I square is equal to pi. So therefore, this integral, which is known as a Gaussian integral, is equal to root pi. So this is extensively used in physics, all branches of physics. So it will be good that if you remember this. And in fact, using this, you may write it in the piece of paper, that you can show that e to the power of minus alpha x square plus beta x is equal to square root of pi by alpha exponential minus beta. I leave it as an exercise. Let's go whole square karna. You take alpha outside, you get x square minus beta by alpha x, and then make it a whole square, beta by 2 alpha whole square minus beta by 2 alpha whole square, and then make a change of variables and you will get this. This equation, actually this is known as the Gaussian integral, and you must all remember this, okay? We will also use this. Now, this is a Gaussian function. So this is also a very important function, and I have plotted this for different value of sigma. At x is equal to 0, it is 1 over sigma under root of 2 pi. So as the value of sigma decreases, the value of the function at x is equal to 0 increases. And in fact, it is such that if I integrate this, then it is 1 for all values of x. At x is equal to, now I want to calculate the full width at half maximum. Jab iska value yahan se half ho jata hai, to uska width kitna hai? How much is the width? So I take at what value of x this exponential becomes half. So let us suppose it becomes half at 2x naught, at x naught. So e to the power of minus x naught square by 2 sigma square is equal to half. So therefore, if I take the logarithm, I will get minus x is 0 square by 2 sigma square is equal to minus log 2. And therefore, the full width at half maximum, which is 2x naught, is 2 under root log 2 sigma, 2.4 sigma. So, as the value of sigma decreases, the full width of at half maximum also decreases. Let me try to highlight this. This is the half width, full width at half maximum. This is the value of x naught. This value is x naught, where the function has half of the peak value. Similarly, for the second curve, the half appears here. So this is the full width at half maximum. This is the full width at half maximum. And for sigma is equal to 0.4, so it is like this. So as the value of sigma decreases, the value, the full width at half maximum decreases. So if I have a Gaussian function like this, then it's full, the width of the Gaussian function is equal to about 2 times sigma, or of the order of sigma. This is a very important result that I have derived, that I that you will, you must remember, that of a Gaussian function, the full width is approximate, is about, that is full width at half maximum. It is this thing that I'm referring to. So the integral under the curve, if you use the Gaussian integral, is 1. So therefore, So as the value of sigma decreases, it becomes sharply peaked with a smaller width. But the area under the curve remains the same for all values of sigma. That is, the integral under the curve is always 1, no matter what the value of sigma is. So therefore, this is yet another representation of the Dirac delta function. So therefore, you have the Gaussian representation. You may write it down. I hope all of you have a pencil and paper. The delta of x minus a is equal to limit as sigma tends to 0. This is known as a Gaussian representation of the Dirac delta function. So this is a very beautiful animation created by Dr. Oleg Alexandrov. And it can be seen at the, so you see, this is my Gaussian function. And he has shown that as the value of sigma decreases, it becomes more and more sharply peaked. But at all values of sigma, the area under the curve is unity. And so therefore, in the limit of sigma tending to 0, you have the Dirac delta function. Let me consider another function. This is very important. Listen to this very carefully. I'm sorry, I'm telling you, listen to this. Some of you may be very senior, but I'm addressing only the students. Consider the sinc function, which is sine of g x minus a divided by pi x minus a. At x is equal to a, both the numerator is 0, the denominator is 0. So sine theta in the limit of theta tending to zero becomes theta, where theta is measured in radians. Remember that. So sine theta becomes theta, so g times x minus a divided by pi times x minus a. So it becomes g by pi. So as the value of g increases, it becomes sharply peaked. And the first zero occurs at pi over at x is equal to a plus pi by g. Pi by g. This distance is pi by g. So as the value of g increases, the width, the full width at half maximum decreases. And it so happens, this I have done in my optics book, the integral using simple Laplace transform techniques, this integral is always one irrespective of the value of g. Irrespective of the value of g. So you will have, when g becomes very large, this is probably for g equal to 100 or something like that. I did the calculations long time back. It becomes very sharply peaked and it suddenly drops to zero. The width becomes very, very small. So therefore, it has all the properties of the delta function. And this is yet another representation of the Dirac delta function. And then this function can be written like this, because I can integrate this with respect to k, e to the power of plus minus ix is equal to e to the power of plus minus ix divided by plus minus I, and then evaluate it and you will get this sine function. So if I take the limit g tending to infinity, then the limits will become from minus infinity to plus infinity. I'm saying it slowly so that those of you who want to take down notes can at least take it. Otherwise, everything is given in the optics book, and most of the things are given in the quantum mechanics book of mine. So therefore, I have yet another representation of the Dirac delta function. Delta of x minus a is equal to 1 over 2 pi this. And so to summarize, this is the definition of the Dirac delta function. So this is the definition of the Dirac delta function, that it is zero, as I had mentioned earlier, for x not equal to a, and this integral is f of a. And I find that there are many representations of that. You have the representation of in the form of rectangle function. That is a representation. Derivative of the Heaviside unit step function. That is also a good representation. Or a limiting form of the Gaussian function. That is also a very good representation of the Dirac delta function. And then you have this. This is known as the integral representation of the Dirac delta function. So these are all representations of the Dirac delta function. Now, I will just concentrate on the integral representation of the Dirac delta function. And then you have, as I told you before, this is the definition of the Dirac delta function. As most some of you may know, f of x is equal to delta of x minus x prime, f of x prime. So in this integral, I substitute this value. I substitute this. To Fourier double integral ho jayega. So you write f of x is equal to 1 over 2 pi e to the power of plus minus I k x minus x prime, f of x prime, dx prime and dk. This equation is known as the Fourier integral theorem. This is a very important result. I'll repeat. This function, this equation is the represent the integral representation of the delta function. And we have shown that if the delta function is multiplied by an arbitrary well-behaved function, then it picks up the value at x is equal to x prime. The integral is over x prime here. So it will be f of x. Now what I do is, I substitute this in this. So I get 1 over 2 pi as this. This equation is known as the Fourier integral theorem. And I have rewritten the Fourier integral theorem. And so thus, if we define the here, f of k is equal to f of x prime e to the power of minus I k x prime dx prime. And then I have removed the prime. Because these are the only three terms which depend on x prime. A term, f of x prime, and e to the power of minus I k x prime, and dx prime. Or prime ko maine hata diya. It is now dx. Because it's a definite integral. I can always replace x prime to x. So if we define, actually there should have been three equal to signs. F of k defined to be equal to this. Then f of k is known as the Fourier transform of the function f of x. And the inverse Fourier transform f of x will be 1 over under root 2 pi. F of k e to the power of I k x. So these two functions form what is known as the Fourier transform pair. If I had written down this as e to the power of plus I k x, then this would have become e to the power of minus I k x. Both are used. And now I will give you the physical interpretation. So I have proved to you that if f of k is defined as the Fourier transform of f of x, then the inverse Fourier transform, then f of x is the inverse Fourier transform of f of k. I hope this is clear. Let me take a time-dependent function. Consider a time-dependent function f of t. And I write it its Fourier transform like this. So this is known as the frequency spectrum. I will tell you the physical significance of that. Then the inverse Fourier transform, what is this? This is superposition of different frequencies. So if you have only one frequency, f of omega, then f of omega will be delta of omega minus omega naught. Oh, I should have written that. If f of omega is delta of omega minus omega naught, I hope you all can understand this. Then I integrate this, I will get e to the power of minus omega naught t, omega zero t. So this is the frequency spectrum. F of omega is the frequency spectrum of the function f of t. Now let me consider an optical pulse with a Gaussian envelope. Optical pulse, tau represents the full width of half maximum, 2 tau or something like that, as I had mentioned. This is a Gaussian function. So what I do is, I take a laser pointer, switch it on and switch it off, and produce a pulse of duration tau. And I take its Fourier transform. If I substitute this in this equation, then I will also get a Gaussian, which is peaked at omega is equal to omega zero. But tau square now appears in the numerator, so the bandwidth is one over tau. Actually, it should be tau zero, not tau. That's all right. That's all right. So understand what I have done. I consider a pulse. This is not quantum mechanics, although it will have applications in quantum mechanics. I have a laser pointer. I switch it on and switch it off to produce a Gaussian pulse whose time dependence is so much. I take its Fourier transform. Then I get its frequency spectrum. And I use that Gaussian integral to evaluate f of omega. I leave it as an exercise. You write it down. That let us suppose f of t is so much, how much is the Fourier transform? And the tau square is in the numerator. So for example, okay. Sorry. So therefore, it Fourier transform, I wanted to show you that Gaussian integral. So you get delta omega will be 1 over tau. So let us suppose this is my laser pointer. I switch it on and switch it off to produce a pulse. So here I am standing. And you see a pulse of duration, say 1 nanosecond or 1 picosecond. I repeat it again. Just see that a pulse moves in this direction. So its Fourier transform is given by this. So that the frequency width is 1 over tau zero. So delta omega delta t is 1. There's no quantum mechanics here. This is the uncertainty principle. If you multiply by h cross omega h cross, then delta e delta t is equal to 1, is equal to h cross. So here I have a pulse. These are exact numerical calculations that I have done. It's a 20 femtosecond Gaussian pulse. Femtosecond is 10 to the power of minus 15 seconds. So I switch on the laser pointer and switch it off after 20 femtosecond. So because it has a finite duration, it has a spectral width. And that spectral width is 1 over tau naught, as I have tried to show. Actually, it should be tau, not tau naught. I hope all of you follow this. Similarly, I consider a pulse of duration tau c. It's not a Gaussian, but it is 0 beyond this, 0 beyond this. So this is something like, as some of you may have read, the coherence time, that a pulse remains sinusoidal for only tau c. Tau c, therefore the subscript tau c, the actual electric field is the real part of that, cos omega zero t. So if I take the Fourier transform, I leave it as an exercise, then I get this sync function. So I must tell you one more thing. that in the limit of tau becoming infinity, f of omega will approach a delta function. And so therefore one frequency, omega equal to omega naught. Because tau is in the numerator, and we had seen the Gaussian representation of the delta function. So if tau is the duration of the pulse becomes infinite, then becomes very large, then f of omega becomes monochromatic. So if the duration of the pulse was very, very large, then this becomes smaller and smaller and taller until you get it in the limit of tau going to infinity, delta omega becomes zero, and f of omega will become a delta function. I repeat, when the duration of the pulse is very, very large, if it remains coherent for a very large period of time, then the corresponding delta omega becomes smaller and smaller, becomes sharper and sharper, and in the limit of tau zero tending to infinity, f of omega becomes a delta function. Similarly, if tau c becomes larger and larger, so this becomes smaller and smaller and sharper and sharper. And that was my integral representation of the delta function. So again, the frequency spread is inversely proportional to the coherence time. So the first zero, this width is 1 over tau, which is the frequency spread of the pulse. This is the frequency spread of the pulse. So delta omega, the frequency spread of the pulse is 1 over tau c. So for omega 0, which is 3 into 10 to the power of 15 hertz, I should have written hertz here. See, every quantity should have a particular unit. And tau c is equal to 10 to the power of minus 9. So omega 0 tau c is about 3 million. And in this figure, it is about 400. And you can see how sharp it is. So that's how I see, if you produce a 1 nanosecond pulse, you still see red in color because it is still almost monochromatic. Now I have this wave function. Yeah, I hope. Yeah, this is a perfect. So I can write this using the Fourier integral theorem. And then I introduce p is equal to h cross k. And you obtain, instead of k, you write p by h cross. So you get a, for dk, you get dp by h cross. So you get a 2 pi h cross. So therefore, if I define the three sign equal to signs, means I define. So if I define a of p, just as I did in the Fourier transform theory, as under root of 2 pi h cross psi of x e to the power of minus I p x by h cross dx. Actually, these are all primes, but because it is a definite integral, I can remove the primes. And if I define a of p there and I substitute it here, then you get this. Okay. So I had written down the one-dimensional time-dependent Schrödinger equation for a free particle like this. So I try to solve this by using the method of separation of variables. You see, as I told you earlier, I take Schrödinger equation as my Bible, as the truth. And then I play around with it and solve for particular problems. Psi of x comma t, I assume a function of x multiplied by a function of t. This is a very standard method for solving the Schrödinger equation. And I substituted in this Schrödinger equation and I obtain, if I substitute in equation 1 and then I divide by psi times t, I will obtain this. IH cross dt by dt. Now, you see, partial derivatives have been replaced by total derivative. H cross square by 2m, 1 over psi d2 psi by dx square. Dekhiye, here delta psi by delta t means dt by dt multiplied by psi of x. And you have divided by psi of x t of t, so you get 1 over t of t. The psi x cancel out. So then you say, this is the standard procedure that the variables have indeed separated out. The left-hand side is a function of time and the right-hand side is a function of x. This is a very standard method. And you say that the method of separation of variables has worked because the variables have indeed separated out. So a function of time cannot be equal to a function of space unless both of them are equal to a constant. So I write this as E, which is now a number, and which I write as P square by 2m, which is also a number, just like that. Now I equate this with this and this with this. So first of all, the time dependent term I wrote as E is equal to P square by 2m. So I had done first the space dependent part. So you get d2 psi by dx square is it plus P square by h cross square psi of x. So these are known as the, so the solution of this is equal, is given by, oh, there has to be E here. EXP, sorry. Sorry. This is something wrong. EXP, sorry. So this is the momentum eigenfunction. And similarly, if you solve the time part, then you get, this is the space part, and this is the time part. The solution is the multiplication of that, and you get this, where P lies between plus infinity and minus infinity, where P can be any number. You see, P is now a number because this is a constant, and P can take any real value between plus infinity and minus infinity. These are said to be the normalized free particle eigenfunctions. Eigenfunctions as wave functions for corresponding to a free particle whose momentum is given by P. And I have introduced the factor 2 pi h cross so that they are normalized. I will do that later. But you can have any constant, and I have chosen the constant to be equal to 1 over 2 pi h cross. I'll discuss this constant maybe later. So therefore, now this is the most important part. So this is, we have obtained P can take any value between minus infinity to plus infinity. So therefore, the most general solution of the one-dimensional time-dependent Schrödinger equation for a free particle will be a superposition of these plane waves. And since P takes a continuous values, it will be an integral, where A of P is an arbitrary function of P. So therefore, I have been able to derive a very beautiful result. This is the one-dimensional Schrödinger equation for a free particle. V of x is zero everywhere. I describe the electron or the proton or the neutron by a wave function psi. And this forms what is known as a wave packet describing the propagation of the electron. And this is the most general solution of this equation, which is a superposition of plane waves. And that's how I get a pulse, even in the optics experiment that I just now described. It's a superposition of different frequencies that I got that Gaussian pulse. Similarly, for the electron, it's a superposition of different momentum waves. In 1926, of course, this can be justified. Maybe I will show that later. You can see that in any book on quantum mechanics, or I can show that. He said, mod psi of x t squared dx represent the probability of finding the x component of the particle's position to lie between x and x plus dx. And mod ap squared dp is the probability of finding the x component of the particle's momentum to lie between p and p plus dp. So if psi of xt is located within a distance of sigma, then the momentum spread will be located within a distance of h cross by sigma, and that follows from the Fourier transform relationship. And that is my uncertainty principle. So even the uncertainty principle is contained in the solution of the Schrödinger equation. So Schrödinger equation describes entire quantum mechanics. The uncertainty principle, the solutions of this equation are consistent with the uncertainty principle. And that follows from the Fourier transform pair. Okay, now let me show you something. And because, yes, let me then tell you two more things and then probably I will sign off. So let me take a Gaussian function that at t equal to zero, the electron is described by this function. So the probability distribution function, it's a distribution. P of x dx is equal to mod psi x ds square. If I square it, you get a Gaussian function. Then using this, you calculate the corresponding APX as I have shown you earlier by calculating the Fourier transform. And this becomes, so the integral of PX dx from minus infinity to plus infinity is one. Even this integral is one. So if you plot it, then you will find that the width, this is the full width of half maximum, is of the order of sigma naught. And the momentum distribution function has a width of h cross by sigma naught. So therefore, delta x, delta p is of the order of h cross. So therefore, the uncertainty principle is contained in the solution of the Schrödinger equation. Everything is contained in the solution of the Schrödinger equation. So just as we had considered the propagation of a light pulse, the electron is, let us suppose, at t equal to zero, it is moving. It is coming out of a filament or something like that. It is described by this wave packet. It is somewhere localized here. There is an uncertainty in the exposition also. As it propagates, the center of the wave packet moves with a certain group velocity, and then it moves, and there is also a little spreading. But this, as we had discussed, for the time-dependent pulse, that a pulse consists of superposition of different frequencies. This is a superposition of different momenta, such that delta x, delta p is of the order of h cross. Now, some of you may have done this tunneling through a barrier. So I have an alpha particle described by a localized wave packet. It approaches a barrier. And some of you may have calculated the reflection and transmission coefficient. So let us suppose the reflection coefficient is 0.4, the transmission coefficient is 0.6. So a single electron described by this wave packet, which is approaching a potential barrier, when it hits the potential barrier, there is a reflected wave and a transmitted wave. So one single electron is described by a wave packet, which is here as well as there. When you make a measurement, it will collapse to being either here or there. That is the beauty of quantum mechanics. That the wave, a particle can be at two places at the same time before you make the measurement. But the process of measurement disturbs the system, and the wave function collapses to being either here or there. Let me not go through this, but let me give you a simple example. Let us suppose I have a light source which emits single photons, one photon, another photon, another photon. It's a 50% reflector. Some of you may have used it in Michelson's interferometer, a beam splitter. This is a beam splitter. So light comes in, one photon. There's a 50% chance of reflection, 50% chance of transmission. So if you have one photon coming in, let us suppose, you will say, let us suppose there are 10,000 photons, about 500 will come here, about 500 will come there. That is not the correct answer. That is not the correct answer. A single photon is reflected as well as transmitted. It is here as well as here. So it is described by a wave packet, which is here as well as here. So it can be millions of kilometers apart. Before the measurement is made, it is here as well as there. If you have a detector here, then it collapses to being either here or there. So let me if I have a electron beam or a proton beam incident on a slit of width B, then the particle is localized within a distance of the order of B. You have a proper wave function there. It is given. I have worked it out in detail in both my quantum mechanics book and also in the optics book. You please go through that. And you find the Fourier transform of the wave function. You will find a factor like this, sine beta by beta. and the probability that the y component of the momentum lies between y py and p dpy will be equal to this. Now, this is the same expression as you must have obtained in the single slit diffraction pattern. So, when you do the experiment with photons or with electrons or with protons or with neutrons, this is quantum mechanics predicts the probability distribution of the arrival of the electrons or protons on the screen, which is the same as the intensity distribution as predicted in classical optics or classical wave theory. Where will the proton arrive? Where will the electron arrive? One cannot say. But if you did the experiment with a large number of electrons, slowly this diffraction pattern will appear. An individual electron, where it will arrive, one does not know. Classical physics is deterministic in nature, but quantum physics is probabilistic in nature. It gives a probability distribution. This Einstein could never reconcile to. He said, physics must be deterministic. If you know an electron coming in, you should precisely be able to tell where it will arrive on the screen. And this is the actual intensity distribution diffraction pattern of a neutron beam. Similarly, I can work out for the single slit diffraction pattern, double slit diffraction pattern. I have a wave function which is finite here and finite here and zero everywhere else. And then I calculate the corresponding A of py and I square that and multiply it by dp. This will require a little calculation. You get the single slit. This is the probability distribution of the arrival of the electron or the proton or the alpha particle. But this is the same as the intensity distribution as you obtain in your classical wave theory in optics. So therefore, the electron, as it passes through two holes or two slits, it passes through both the holes simultaneously. This is extremely difficult to understand. It is described by a wave function, which is present here as well as there. So you visualize the electron, which has, as I told you in my last lecture, which has a very well-defined mass, very well-defined charge. So how can it propagate through two holes at the same time? This part of quantum mechanics, no one understands. But it is described by the wave function. And we say that the electron passes, or the photon, passes through both the holes at once. And listen to me carefully. It interferes with itself to produce a probability distribution, which is like this, which is the same as predicted by classical wave theory. And so therefore, you obtain, you see, this is the double slit interference pattern of the type that you remember, you must have done this Young's double slit or double hole interference pattern. And this is a very beautiful experiment which has been done with electrons. If you have 10 electrons, you will obtain 10 spots. Because when you detect the electron, it is either one electron or none. Then this is 100. Then this is 3000. And when there are a million electrons, slowly the interference pattern builds up. Where will an individual electron appear? I do not know. I can only tell you the probability distribution. Something similar happens, as you must have known, the radioactivity. Let us suppose you have a radioactive substance like uranium. Let us suppose its half-life is one day. It is actually millions of years. You have identical atoms. Then you say that in one day, half of them will disintegrate. Which atom will disintegrate, you cannot say. You cannot predict. You can only predict the probability distribution. You can say approximately half of them will decay. So some atoms will decay in the next 1 minute. And some atoms will not decay even after 2 years. Which one will stay, which one will decay, no one can predict. And in that sense, quantum mechanics is a probabilistic theory. So it is 1:20 right now. Try to go through the books that I have referred to, and maybe there will be a third lecture sometime later. But organizing this lecture, Dr. Saxena had to put in tremendous amount of effort and coordination. And it is difficult. It is difficult. Although I wanted to have many lectures, but it is very difficult. But it was a pleasure talking to you. And send your comments as to how you liked a quantum slide. The most fundamental, David Bohm, whose book I had shown, Theory Now Available, is probabilistic in form. And David Bohm, as I had mentioned earlier, is widely considered one of the best quantum physicists of all times. Then, this is Richard Feynman. And this is a screenshot of his video lecture in YouTube. You all must watch this. You go to YouTube, write Feynman Messenger Lectures. And there is a one lecture on probability and uncertainty. And what I have tried to do today, I mean, he does it beautifully. So he says, electrons, these are his own words. Electrons do not behave just like particles. They do not behave just like waves. Electrons in orbits, like a Bohr orbit in a hydrogen atom, are not somewhat like a cloud or fog of some sort surrounding the nucleus. It behaves like nothing that you have seen before. Well, there is one simplification. These are his own words. At least electrons behave exactly the same way as photons. And then he says, I think I can safely say that nobody understands quantum mechanics. Thank you very much.